So here we are, another console that's sold on Amazon, a retro emulation console, all set up and ready to go. I don't know how they get away with selling these things on there, but hey, people seem to be interested, so we're going to be taking a look at this one. This is the Frigedaeg, the friggin' retro game box, what I'm going to call it, I guess. But this is supposed to be a cleaner build from what I've been told. It's a little cheaper than the previous ones that I've looked at, those Kinhank, High Avenir, the Bearway, those things. This is supposed to be a little nicer, and it looks like it's a similar setup as far as specs go. Made in China, of course. I have a 256 gigabyte version here, the Game TV Box A95X Smart. It's the smart one. Okay. PSP, PS1. Dreamcast, Neo Geo, all that good stuff, ready to go. So let's go ahead and check out what comes in the box and then do some tests. Like, I want to see how the presentation is, how the game lists look, that kind of thing. Is it worth a damn, performance with certain things? So we'll go ahead and take a look at all that in a moment. But let's get into this box here. So it looks like on this side, okay, we'll get all that out. Power cable, remote, HDMI, and then our little friggin' box right here, the A95X Frigedaeg. It's a very light box. That's about it. Model A95X F3 Air. I mean, the names, like, I guess you're gonna see multiple names all over the place. But there you go, a couple USBs, Ethernet port, HDMI, AV, whatever. There's a lot of stuff, little ventilation down there. Okay, we have our power, HDMI, a remote, because you can use this as like an Android box typically, but I don't really care too much about that. I want to see the setup that they have here as far as gaming goes, because it will have Emulek on here. Oh, and the same old wireless controllers, which I'm not seeing. Oh, the dongles are in the box there, instead of on the inside. These are always, I say they're not the greatest, but they're serviceable. They work decently well. But with these boxes, typically, you can use any controller you want, wireless, wired, Bluetooth, that kind of thing. But if you got nothing else, these will be fine for the most part. They take two AAAs. So let's go ahead and get this thing plugged in, check it out. So the one thing I noticed with this 256 gigabyte build over the previous ones that I reviewed, which will be linked down below so you can check those out, is that this one has a lot less games included, around 60,000 instead of over 114,000. And that may be a con to some people, but I think it could be a plus because those over 100,000 game builds, typically half of the games are duplicates, something around that. So maybe this is a good sign with this setup, but let's go through it. So I think this was the first system I've used from one of these Chinese sellers where I had to configure the included controller on boot up, but that's not a big deal. It just kind of guides you through it. And if you plug in a different controller that you'd prefer to use, it should do the same thing and prompt you to configure the controller. Just follow through what it's showing you. Pretty simple. Now, scrolling through the over 60 consoles they included here, I did notice some differences from other builds I recently looked at. Mostly concerning game counts for some of the systems. It appears some things are filled out nicely, like Neo Geo CD, which I did test and it seems like all these games play extremely well, and there's not much in the way of duplicates here, with that system anyway. And then there are things like Naomi and other consoles that seem to have more games, or what seems to be just more of a complete library, so that was pretty cool. It really does appear this is a different build and not just simply recycled again from all these other consoles these companies put out there. But of course, there will be similarities across all these things. The full game libraries don't magically change for individual systems, but how many games from that library that they include can change. So it is nice to see some differences here. But now, after inspecting the different consoles, definitely the same old shenanigans pop up. I was really hoping this one would be a lot cleaner than other builds, but it's not. And what do I mean by that? So most of your Nintendo systems, arcade stuff, and some Sega consoles will have a bunch of duplicates,
from across every region all compiled into one list. Now, I don't care about including multiple regions when selling this to people around the world. I mean, I get it, but it is lazy to not categorize them. Even if you can't figure out how to create a specific wheel for that region, you can put those games into folders to more neatly organize things to make it easier to look through the game list. But yeah, it's the same thing once again. And you will find in this build, it looks like most of the metadata and screenshots are complete, but you will find holes here and there that just have no information, just the game name, no screenshot, no video, that kind of thing. But okay, it's not the cleanest setup, but it's definitely nowhere near the worst anyway. I do think with this one, I personally could clean it up quite a bit easier than previous ones, but it's still worth noting that the total number of games included is just not true. There's tons of duplicates here, so keep that stuff in mind. Now, the important stuff, which that is important to me as well, but performance is the main thing. So I wanted to check out a few systems here, like 3DO. And this time, Need for Speed does work. It's not that weird dating game that they keep kind of sliding in there, but Need for Speed, it just runs really slow. And then Samurai Showdown on the 3DO also has that same background glitch that I keep seeing on these things where nothing shows up. But you will find some stuff that runs okay on 3DO, like Wolfenstein, but there's not much of a list of games here for 3DO, so a good number of them are just not going to run well. You might find a couple. Now, Dreamcast has a small list of games, and I found that there were a few that wouldn't boot, which is typically not normal. Usually, if they would boot, maybe some wouldn't work right or play bad, but yeah, here I found a few that just wouldn't run. Then Naomi, I noticed, has a lot more games, so I checked a few out, and performance on these, they do seem pretty good. You know, both Naomi and Dreamcast for sure, though. You will find games that don't run 100% or have some minor issues, but the games I randomly went through and chose that actually ran, they ran fine, so that was cool. Now, Nintendo 64, I wanted to try a few games, as it's always a mixed bag situation here. Now, last time, I remembered having issues with the Cruisin' games, and this time they do all load up, but Cruisin' USA runs poorly, yet the other two seem to run okay. Cruisin' USA, for whatever reason, is always a problem game, but yeah, there you go. Now, I noticed Sega Saturn has what appears to be the same game list as the Ken Hank I recently reviewed, so I did have issues with Street Fighter Alpha on that build, but here, it's almost playable. It's not as bad as the other builds for whatever reason, but it still runs a little slow. Now, PlayStation 1, I always say you can run on a potato, so it shouldn't be a problem here, and that's typically true, but I did find some bad ROMs in this list of 700 games for the PlayStation. Some just didn't have music, some wouldn't load. It just seems like bad rips, because these games should run just fine. You can replace them if you so choose. Now, I also noticed PSP and PSP minis were separated and thought that was cool, but nah, PSP doesn't have any normal PSP games in its list from what I could tell. It's just filled out with tons of minis, so they have two categories for minis. And then I did try a few of those, and I found some of these mini games did have performance issues, unfortunately. Now, Open Bore is filled up with games, and it seems most of them run okay, but yeah, I cannot test every single game here or showcase every single game in the list that's included, so it can be difficult to tell you how everything performs, as some systems can have games that work and some that just don't. I just hope to give you a better idea of what to expect with something like this. Most, if not all, of your old 8 and 16-bit systems and handhelds are going to be no problem, I think. I mean, besides all the duplicates anyway. But yeah, this is a typical build on a cheap Android box. And I do understand the appeal for some people who don't have the time or ability or desire to make their own setup. There's tons of reasons why not to. But I do get a lot of people asking me on these videos, which system would I recommend out of all these little consoles that they sell on Amazon and eBay and whatnot? And here's my honest answer. I simply cannot recommend any of them. And why? Because none of these that I've used or, you know, had for a video review have been something where I decided this is going to be the way I play these games. So how could I recommend something I don't personally use myself? As far as a small single console that can play most of the lower end games this thing can handle, I'd rather use a PlayStation Classic with an AutoBloom build, or a Raspberry Pi with RetroPie. And then for my more demanding games, more, you know, higher end systems, I've been happy using my Steam Deck or even just my PC. So there you go. That's my answer, finally, I guess. But I mean, some people should have realized that, who've been following me anyway. But those options that I just mentioned, they're not ready to go typically unless you find someone selling one pre-set up, right? But also, I think for things like RetroPie and AutoBloom, if you're able to, there's plenty of builds from people who know what they're doing, and they put them out there for download for people. And that's like the simplest, cheapest way, in my opinion. But the main problem is if you don't already have a Raspberry Pi or PlayStation Classic, the prices have gone up quite a bit and they're not exactly cheap. Though Raspberry Pis at some point should be easier to get for retail, but right now there's a lot of third-party, you know, sellers scalping them. So I understand these Chinese ready-to-go consoles may be appealing to some people. Just be ready to find some things you were hoping to play not running or not running properly. So yeah, keep your expectations in check. Appreciate you guys watching. Catch you on the next one. Bye.